What's up guys, it's Ekrakun back with another video, and in this video we're going to be talking about, is the MacBook Pro 2012 unibody any good for editing in 2020? So I own a MacBook Pro 2012 unibody 13-inch, which is the one without the graphics card. And this can be actually quite good, because the one with the graphics card, which is the 15-inch variant, has a lot of common problems with that graphics card. So if you want the more reliable one, the 13-inch is the better version to get. But if you're talking about editing here, the 15-inch version has a quad-core i7, while the 13-inch version only has a dual-core i7, which has close to half the performance, which is a huge decrease in performance, while the 15-inch version is actually not a bad processor in general. It does still hold back a bit in 2020, but it isn't that bad. But anyway, let's get into some of the tests and results I've been getting with these machines. Now, personally, I don't have a 15-inch variant, but I do know that the processor that's in the 15-inch variant is very similar to my Dell Inspiron, so I'm going to be basing my test results off that. If you don't like that, then maybe watch a different comparison, but this is what I have, so this is what I'll have to base my test results from. So with a 13-inch MacBook Pro 2012, you will notice that it does thermal throttle a lot. I'm not too sure in the 15-inch's case, but in the 13-inch, it throttles a heap. It gets to 100 degrees very easily, which will decrease the rendering performance. So let me get into the Cinebench R20 scores of both machines. So the 13-inch version scores about a 650 CB multi-core score in Cinebench R20, while a 15-inch version, judging by my Dell Inspiron i7 scores about a 1100 CB, which is quite good. It falls just a bit behind a Ryzen 3200G, which is a pretty decent, very budget processor. And also, if you're wondering why I gave you the results of a Cinebench R20 score, this is because Cinebench R20 is a really good representation of how the processor will work when video rendering, because it has a very similar workload. But anyway, with that out the way, let me talk about the rendering times. So with a 13-inch, with a 5-minute 4K render, you'll expect about a 25-minute long render time, while with a 1080p clip, you can expect about a 13 to 15 minute render time. So rendering in 4K does make it a lot slower, but let's compare it to the 15-inch scores. So with the 15-inch scores from my Dell Inspiron, I was able to get a 13 to 15 minute render time on the 5-minute 4K clip, while at 1080p, it scores about 6 to 7 minutes. So it's not too bad, but it isn't anything exceptional in 2020. It's still pretty poor. Now, of course, these results may vary for you. It depends how many lumetri grades you've got on top and how many effects and transitions you put into the video, but this is just from my average with an average amount of lumetri colors and transitions in the video. It was just an ordinary video I rendered for YouTube. So hopefully this gave you a good idea of how the rendering performance was. Now let me talk about the general playback in the timeline and stuff. So I had recorded some footage in 1080p with my Canon 70D, which is what I'm recording this video with now. This camera shoots 1080p in about 90 megabits per second. So that's about 652 megabytes for 1 minute of footage. So it is quite big, but on my PC here, it runs perfectly fine at full resolution. So when I put it onto my Dell Inspiron, it ran perfectly fine, even at full resolution, just playing and scrubbing through the footage and chopping down stuff, it ran fine, quite smooth actually, I was quite impressed. While with the 13-inch version, it does start to stutter at full resolution. So you'll have to change it to about half or 1/4, which just shows that this machine is really not going to be good for editing. While the 15-inch isn't too bad for editing, it is still pretty bad, but it's not too bad. So the general timeline performance is actually quite good, and putting effects and stuff and rendering like stabilization and stuff like that was actually quite fast on the 15-inch, while on the 13-inch, it's pretty slow, that's all I can say. It's a slow machine, it's not designed for rendering videos and stuff. So in conclusion, should you get a MacBook Pro 2012 unibody for video editing? Well, a 15-inch version, it's not going to be too bad. It's not going to be anything exceptional, while a 13-inch is absolutely horrible and I wouldn't recommend it at all for video rendering or video editing. So pretty much, I wouldn't recommend either of them for video editing, but if you are desperate for one of those for editing, get a 15-inch that has no graphic card errors and that's tested that the graphics card works fine and everything, so then you won't get a dud or something like that. But with that all out the way, drop a like on the video if it helped you out, drop a dislike if you didn't enjoy the video, remember to subscribe, and I'll catch you guys in the next video.